Now, you're very welcome along. If you're watching on our social channels or if you're listening on the radio, we have Bernard Brogan in studio. Bernard, you're very welcome. Thanks for popping in.
Appreciate it. Yeah.
Good to have you in. You're here. People know you have a long affiliation with SuperValu. They have a 10-year sponsorship now with the GAA at this stage, and you're highlighting their Where You're From campaign, which does what it says on the tin, basically.
Yeah, it was a nice campaign this year. My piece of it was kind of focusing on the resilience and a few of the challenges. The TV ad was a real powerful piece around some of the challenges we go through as athletes, be it injury, be it whatever the kind of personal challenges are, headspace, whatever it is. And for me, last year doing the cruciate was a tough year. I was getting a bit older and not knowing where you stand. So it was kind of a tough personal journey for me. And SuperValu got behind the story, and I thought it was a really nice campaign. And where you're from is obviously very important. The grassroots nature of the GAA is important, and our club is very important, our family is very important, and where we're from and what it means. So I thought it was a really, really nice angle on it, yeah.
When the ad comes on the TV for the 200th time, are you cringing going, oh my God? Or are you saying, everyone, I'm on again, quiet?
Yeah, like I would have cringed in the past over certain things, but I've got some great feedback over this one. I think what happened was we were all meant to do our own voiceovers of the different pieces, and I read one out. I really liked the concept, and I do a lot of work, pep talk, a lot of work around resilience and mental health and getting the best out of yourself and potential. So I did a read of the full script, and they kind of said, actually, you know what? I think it was just a bit too broken up, everyone doing it, so I ended up doing the read for the whole ad, which I was delighted to do because some great stories with Andy and Val and the other guys. So it was an honour to kind of to read their story a bit as well. So like sometimes with TV ads, and you don't look back at them and say that'd be one for the memory books, but I think it's a nice one to have that we'll be at the show in future days.
Absolutely. So how have the celebrations been for you over the last couple of weeks? This is All-Ireland number 7 now.
Yeah. A little bit more tamer for me. I still haven't shaved, as you can see. I forgot that I'm always this is always recorded, so I would have cleaned myself up a bit better, but brilliant. Like, we did a few great days, and as you probably saw from social media, the younger lads had 4 or 5 great days, which is great, but
Where do you go at this stage? Where does the team go on the Monday? Sunday now it was.
Where do we go on Sunday? God. The lads bounced from Temple Bar, there's a bit of life around there. We ended up in the Badass, ended up in Bad Bob's, ended up in Coppers, as we always do. On Saturday night we ended up in House downstairs. Alan Clancy do a bit of business in the bar trade, and he opened up the doors for us downstairs, and the rest of the lads went on the Coppers. So we're well looked after in this town for a few points. I can't complain about that, and we always have been over the last 8 years or 9 years, whatever it's been.
And does it for you feel in any way bittersweet, any way less satisfying, any different to those days when you're the main man? I presume it must in some respects.
Yeah, like, it's a different type of feeling. Like, I obviously had my own personal challenge to be relevant this year, to add something to the team. And when you go from a player that tries to play and tries to get scores, and that's when you feel you're doing your bit. This year I kind of consciously tried to look at other angles. So yes, I wanted to be on the pitch and I wanted to do what I could and score and do whatever, but I was never going to get full game time. I was always fighting for a few minutes. But I tried to help others. I tried to help some of the other forwards. I tried to chat to them. I tried to bring in some of my experiences and meetings and different experiences. And we knew we were going to go to war, that we were going to meet a challenge along the way, which we did. But we did it with a great Kerry team. And
did you enjoy that, or was that a constant effort to remind yourself going in, I need to be positive here, I need to be up for it, or did you find it enjoyable?
It's tough, you want to play, we're competitive animals, you always want to put the best foot forward, you want to be out there in the mix, and that's first and foremost. If you don't think like that, there's no point in being there, because you're not going to add value to the group. So, but I did get some kind of power out of it. Like, I got different conversations with lads, and different lads talking to me and saying that I'm helping them, or hearing something that someone said. Like, it's little things, like little small wins you need along the way just to give yourself energy. It's like anyone, someone's playing well, you say you're chipping away nicely there, you're striking the ball well, keep at it. Like, you love hearing that when you're playing. So I enjoyed hearing when lads were saying that they appreciated and saw the work I was putting in on the pitch, and they loved that I was bringing a positive energy around, that they knew what, it was obvious that I was going through challenges and I wanted to get out there, and I was still finding my form coming back through the National League. I wasn't great coming into the summer, then I was feeling a lot better, and as after club championship, I had a good run in club championship. It gave me a bit of confidence pre-club championship. I wasn't sure where I stood. Had a good couple of games, and then as the weeks went on, I just got better and better, felt better and better, and felt like I was adding to the group. And coming up to the last, like getting in the last 26, as you know, Jim doesn't give any jerseys for sentiment or for anything, which I'm well aware of. So to get in there, it was genuinely on merit. I actually moved really well on the Saturday before, scored 4 points in the 20-minute training game, and I was putting real pressure on, and I was ready to do a job if needed on the day. Mm. Wasn't the lads, the goal in the second half kind of made it, kind of gave us a bit of comfort, and maybe kind of took a bit of steam out of Kerry. But if the game had been closer, you never know. You might have needed a striker to get in and get a score. So, yeah, it wasn't to be in the day, but I was part of it. I was there on merit, and I know that myself. And that's sometimes it's inside. You know, you've given everything, and you know that you've added value to the group. It's good enough for me. Good enough for me.
Is it? Yeah. So when you're sitting there, or you're having a pint in the last few days, inside you're thinking, to the outside, this might look like it hasn't quite come off for me, but deep down, I know what I did this year, yeah, and I can live with it. Is that kind of where you are?
Yeah, and I think for me, the people who see behind the scenes, the people in training and the players, that's where you get your real kind of energy from. And I know that lads, throughout the few days having the pints, that lads kind of, well, having pints and getting sentimental, the thing you always do, and lads were saying how much they valued me being around and giving the positive vibes and the different energy I brought this year when I could have kind of put the head down and sulked, yeah, and thrown toys out of pram or giving out the here and there. But I tried to be like, I think I learned that was 2016 when I got dropped for the replay. I kind of, yeah, against Mayo, I tried to put a positive spin on it for no real reason. I think it's the right thing to do. That when Jim told me before the huddle, that when he calls it the team, that I was dropped, in fairness, he gave me the respect to tell me that. So I knew that it was coming. And I'd say to lads, it's the first time I've been dropped in 50 championship games or whatever it was. And lads looked at me kind of just waiting to see a reaction, and I just looked back, everyone looked them in the eye, smiled, stood up, if you need me, I'm coming type feeling. And I heard back that kind of helped the group, so that was enough for me. So that was all I was going to give in any. Even when I'm really disappointed and you're training and you're trying to find motivation. Obviously you have twins at home and busy work life, and some days you go to training and we're all human, like, and it's trying to get that motivation, and motivation dips. You know, some days you're really motivated, some days you aren't, and you just need to keep on driving through, you know.
Tell us about the days where you're not motivated. So you're looking at the fact that you do have twins. I'm sure that's a huge strain on your other half, you know, off to training again. You're trying to build a business. It's never easy.
Yeah.
So on those days where the motivation's low, are the thoughts basically, is this worth it now at this point in my life? Is that the trend of the thoughts, or where are you?
Yeah, like I think once you commit to something, like I was never kind of saying halfway through the year, oh, this isn't working for me, I'm heading off or like that. Like, you know what you made decisions at certain times that, yeah, this is what we're going to do. Chat the gym earlier, pre the year, to say, is there a role for me? Can I add value? There was. We thought there was. Obviously didn't get much game time in the National League for reasons. I kind of started well. I kind of fell out of form a little bit because I was probably just getting frustrated. The team had a couple of slow results early on, so he had to keep his kind of strong team out there. Yeah. Whereas if he had a couple of wins early on, he probably would have rolled in other lads, and I probably would have got two or three games, you know what I mean? And built.
But you need to get going.
Yeah, like I was coming back from an injury, I was feeling really good, I needed to get momentum, and I've always needed momentum to play well. So that wasn't that didn't happen. So went through the whole National League, but I just got 5 minutes at the end in a frustrated state, and didn't really do much. So I was coming out of National League with a challenge. But
so what are you thinking then? On the bad days, you're thinking this ain't happening for me.
Yeah, there was times I was like, am I actually up for this then? Like, you know, will I ever get that turn of pace, that kind of bit of that glint in my eye, that kind of where I feel confident? You need to feel it inside.
Yeah.
And then I went through with a really good week with Dublin, the week of the National League. It was a really powerful week. We did a really powerful session with Gary Keegan, who's our kind of psychologist or sports psychologist.
Incredible reputation, Gary Keegan.
Yeah, he's added bits of magic with us over the years, and that session he did with us. Everyone takes it. It's different from every session you do. People take different things, and it just hit home with me. I said, right, I'm gonna have a look at. I'm gonna push these next 2 weeks. This is it. And then I meet Jim and see where we're at. So I went through the champ. Played Jules, played a really good game, and was striking the ball beautifully. And I met Jim after that, and I said, you know what? I actually think if you if you back me, I think this, I still have something to offer. And he thought the same. He said, I want you around. I think this, like, my gut, I feel there might be something there that you can bring. Right now, probably not. Mm. As in, if we're going to war tomorrow, you're probably not in my 30. But, as you go on, if you kind of get that glint in your eye again, I think there might be something. So he kind of said he believed in me that there's something there. And I felt, it took me a long time through the summer because obviously didn't get much game time like that. The Tyrone game, I felt sharp. I felt still didn't feel that inner positivity. I got out there, I think every ball I touched, something positive came of it. Like, I set up Cozzy for a goal straight away. He missed it. I got a score. I won a kick out. We got a goal off it. I made a turnover. We got a score. I got four or five possessions, but in my head, I'm trying to take all the positives out of this. Like, you only get 10 minutes. You have to find. Work what you got. So that's it here. That was the only game time I got this year. So I was trying to analyse that and see where I could bring something. And then at the end of it, the Saturday actually before, I was always trying to be, I felt my role this year or the last couple of years would be the pivot man, as in give the ball, pop it off to a Con or a Mania, and be that kind of that anchor and full forward or corner forward and be creative and see the gaps, which I felt I could offer. And it just wasn't resonating, I think, with managing. I wasn't showing or whatever like that. And actually the Saturday before the All-Ireland, I said, do you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to take a leaf out of Conor Callaghan's book and I'm going to put the head down and I'm going to just go for it. Like.
Right.
So the first four balls that came in, I took my man on and got four scores. Or Owen O'Gara, me and Owen moved together a couple of times and we ended up like in eight balls. We got six points between us.
Right.
And Deems and Cybulus, I think we just for 15 minutes, 20 minutes, we were on fire. Like, and my head was like, why haven't I been doing this all year? Like, back, maybe I was starting to doubt myself, but I should have just been just doing what I always did, like, goal-getter, putting the head down and going for it. So,
but that must have been a sweet moment that, like, actually, I can still sort of do this. I'm not deluding myself here at the moment.
Yeah, like that was for me, was the magic of the year, and that's why I could sit happier having not played in the final, because I'd done it then. In my head, that was what it was. That's where this year I got it, obviously injured last year. Can I compete? Can I be?
Yes.
Can I be up there with the level likes of Mannion and Conn and these lads and Dino and who are sensational footballers and the rest of the lads are there, but I didn't feel like I was there. I felt like I was a gap between us. And then
you don't want to be like you're along for the ride.
Yeah,
you
and like I wasn't, and I was pushing on. And that Saturday, I felt I was toe to toe with them.
Good.
You know what I mean? And that was magic for me.
When do you find out you're not in the squad at all for the drawn game?
Just before the training session, so 2 days out. So what is it? The game was on Sunday, so Friday night. So Jim would make a few phone calls and give lads a bit of time and have a chat with people, lads, in case they wanted to have a bit of feedback or have a chat or whatever like that. So
how quick is the conversation?
It's disappointing. Like, I was moving well. Obviously, came out of Tyrone game. I would have liked to push on and felt I was in play for the first game. But I didn't, like, did I feel like I was going to get game time? I didn't feel as strong or as confident as going into the replay. So it was more actually the Mayo game that I was more disappointed in not travelling, when I actually felt coming out of the Super 8s and felt like I was moving well and felt like I could add something to that type of a game where it's man-to-man. It's like, that's the type of football I was born to play, like man-to-man, not the blanket defence. It's when you're just pitting yourself against your man, you can take him on, you can get your scores, you don't have to beat two men every time. So I thought that I could have added a lot of more value there. So I was more disappointed about that one than the Kerry one. It was inevitable if not playing the Mayo one. I kind of felt that was kind of
the writing's on the wall.
I played well in training coming up to it, but I hadn't blown out of water, you know. So so yeah, like, you're competing with, like, to actually make a difference, you have to be ridiculously good in training because you have to get past the Kev Mack, Paddy Andrews, Paddy Small, obviously, and then the Conn, Mannion, Cadino, like, there's eight forward, Owen O'Gara,
Connolly,
Conor McHugh, like, there's eight or nine full forwards there, just, and not even the half forwards, some of them are half forwards, I suppose, but the people competing for the forward line, there's seven or eight lads there that play in most counties, you know what I mean?
Like, it's still an unbelievably sickening moment, I'm sure, because in your mind, well, this is my last chance, potentially, in an All-Ireland final. Who do you tell? Who do you talk to? How do you get your head straight? Because it is, I presume, a horrible moment. Who do you talk to?
Yeah, obviously after the All-Ireland, or the Kerry call from Jim, I just rang Ciara, and
That's your other half?
Yeah,
your
wife, my wife. And I just said to her, I said, just got the call from Jim, not in, like, and tried to be positive. I was very upset, like, it was this, like,
you
know, it was a big day, it's All-Ireland final, not to be there with the lads after working so hard to get there.
Did you call your dad or Alan, or?
No, what did I say, talk to Alan. Like, Alan would always kind of chat to me, and he'd kind of leave me at bay because he's obviously in the media, he's writing stuff, so he doesn't want to put me in an awkward position, so he kind of says, maybe the day of the game, he might give me a shout and say, where are you fixed the night before? Just say, where are you at? Like, obviously, he just wants me to play, and he went on a serious campaign the week before the replay to get me there, so he's taking a lot of credit to get me there. You nearly had every publisher database and digital news watering hole in the country talking about trying to get me in and stuff like that, so he's just trying to get his bro out there, you know. So I didn't go shouting from the rooftops. I spoke to my mum and dad, we were knocked over the night before, or that was this Friday and the Saturday, and knocked just up to the kids, so I told them, and they're obviously disappointed, but they were all like, because they weren't,
what can they do? Oh, look, I'm sure they're sad for you and angry for you and upset for you, that's the reality.
They wouldn't say it to me, they might be giving out behind the back, and they'd be giving out about Jim and stuff like that to their friends and all that, and all the usuals.
Jim Gavin's ears were burning, Well, I saw your dad doing something the morning of the game, and you could just tell, he was just upset, you know, of course he was. And the really horrible thing for you, it strikes me, when you're not even in the squad then, is it's not like, oh, I need to get my head right in case I'm off the bench.
Yeah.
It's like, I feel like a spare tool here, probably.
I wasn't sure how to approach the game then, you know what I mean? It was tricky like that.
Pizza Saturday night and a few beers.
Yeah, literally. I had a couple of beers in front of the night before, like, and I just didn't go too mad in case I get the call, sure, you know what I mean? Like, it's like bringing the boots to the match, like, I was going to bring them in, like.
Did you?
No, I didn't, know. But I felt like it, but yeah, it was obviously a weird sensation to your team, to the lads you go to the train with, the week in, week out, not to be there, but there's 8 or 9 other lads that have to do the same, you know. I've just been lucky enough to not be in that position that often. So it was a tough one. I brought the lads in, the twins and Kira, and we went into Littlewood's work with us with Legacy on the communication side. We went in with them into the box, so we kind of, I wanted to stay out of the kind of.
So you're not around the team hotel that morning, really?
No, you're not in that. I drove in with Kira and the lads, parked up the back of Gill's pub, or across from Gill's pub there.
Are people around, people seeing you?
I had my sunglasses on, and we walked quickly, like, and I had the two lads, so we did with a kid each, so we were just legging it through. So
how are you feeling then? It really must be hitting you then.
It wasn't too bad, I was actually just, like, once I got into the game, I actually got really nervous around the game, and that near the end, I felt like, it was, obviously, the game was going against us, and we dug it out again, which has been our biggest strength, you know, to show the resilience of that grit, to not let it go. So, fairness to the lads, they dug it out. Maybe on the bench, you don't feel as much because you're trying to be tuned into the game in case you come on, but I was a nervous wreck watching the game.
I'd say replay happens, and you're driving home thinking, okay,
I'm back on here.
You must have a little bit. I can't believe it's a draw.
I put down the bottle of beer I had. I said, "Jeez, okay, that's the end of them." And we went downstairs and went into the team. I brought Kira out and the lads, and brought the met her mum and dad, so that they bring the twins home, because we were planning obviously the function at night and all that. Sure, so they have a big plan and logistics of moving the twins and the lads home and all that back and forth. So I said to Kira, "I'll drive down." She said she'd go home, so I went down to the team and just met the guys and just kind of debrief and get together, and it was just like, let's back to Gibson, get your cars, and we're back
home,
recovery tomorrow, and off we go again, and new opportunity for people. So I was energised by it. I knew that there was opportunities, there was chances missed, there was opportunities for us to win and lose, but it was an opportunity for a striker to get in there and do a job, and that's all I saw in it, you know.
And 2 weeks later, does Jim ring you to say you're in?
He rang me and I met him before the session. So he rang me and I said, I don't want you, I said, for a call with you. I'm sorry, for to meet you in person. So I walked in, I said,
what did you think that meant?
I said, if you're making a call, I said, I want to make it hard for you. I said, I don't want you to have to make it easy for you. I said, if you're going to drop me again, you're going to do it to me face.
Yeah.
So, Jim, in fairness, if you want to give him feedback, he's open here. So I just said, you know what, I prefer to meet you. I was in a bit of work, and I said, I can't take a call now, I'll meet you, and I'll be down early at 5 o'clock. So I went in and was having a chat, and the usual, you know how much respect you to football, and I'm kind of going, oh yeah, I've heard this one before, and this, yeah, the nice slant before you give you the bad news, and went on, and he just said, you've worked really hard, you've been so positive, you're talking to meetings, you're doing this, that, and the other, and so you're in. So I knew, and he fell off the chair. I was expecting the worst, like you would, like training had gone well, and it was on Saturday, but you never know, because you have like to get in, somebody has to move, you know what I mean? And that's the reality of the 26. I think it's actually a ridiculous thing, having lived through it.
It's crazy.
When you have 33 lads training and killing themselves, and there's five seats behind you in the dugout that are free. Like,
crazy.
It's madness.
Not fair, really, in an amateur sport as well and everything else.
Yeah, lads are giving their lives to something, you know what I mean? I'm sure it will be, I've heard other people saying as well, but I haven't lived through it. Obviously, if you're playing, you don't really worry about it, but when you've actually lived through it, to be left behind after training so hard and giving everything to an amateur sport to represent your parish and your club and your county, God, at least they could do is bring you on the day, do you know what I mean?
I'd say you've a new appreciation for you've had this brilliant long career and so many great days. I'm sure you were aware of the lads who weren't on the bus with you on the big days, but you must have such a deeper appreciation of those lads flogged themselves equally, didn't go to mates' weddings, ate well, you know, looked after themselves and didn't get to go there.
Yeah, lads like Conor McHugh and that, who didn't get to see much game time or final day, he was a quality forward, and to see, I suppose, the attitude, and Keane O'Connor, these young lads are coming through, the attitude in training, the attitude to the homework that we do, the analysis, their feedback, like they're given the same effort and want and analysis that a starter is given, do you know what I mean? And that's a credit, like, do you know what I mean? Sometimes I find it hard. Now, analysis, I'm of an older generation, analysis and stuff would never have been my forte, but obviously it's part of the game now, but when you see lads like that, they just continuously dig it out, like, and do their bit for the team. That's where I've really resonated with me over the last couple of years, been on that side of it. And
I saw you on the pitch with your twins afterwards, and I'm sure it's just a much better ending for a host of reasons. You're in your gear, and there you are. And actually, Jim came over for a picture with you and the twins as well. And kind of have all those moments. So that must just be so much easier to stomach and to take. Have you made up your mind at this stage on the pitch about your future? Is this you thinking, this is my last time on a pitch with all these lads?
Yeah, well, for me, not there and then. Like, that's a decision I'm going to meet Jim next week, actually, to have a chat about it. So, but then it's just like, for me, it's like, it's about family again. Like, I got those in my wall at home, in my kitchen, is me and the two lads when they're 8 weeks old, last year. And all I want to do is get them back there, do you know what I mean? Obviously you want to win, you get to play football and get out there, but that was an evening game. I was obviously wasn't sure if I was going to be involved. If I wasn't involved, the lads were, it's past their bedtime, do you know what I mean? So they weren't coming.
Yeah.
I was going to be involved. So I said, you know what? I said, Ciara, look, bring them in. We'll organise logistics. And fairness, Ciara, she had the hard graft bringing them in.
I feel like Ciara's definitely holding up her end of the bargain in this relationship, to be honest.
She is, in fairness, now. Yeah. No, she's been great. Like, and she's dug in, and it's she's kind of every Tuesday, Thursday, Monday night training in the gym, and then Saturday and Sunday mornings from 9 till 1, 9 till 3 some days. The hours that go into it are frightening. Like, you go on a Tuesday, you think it's just training on Tuesday night, you land there at 5 o'clock for a 6 o'clock meeting, obviously half an hour of prep and talking, and you're not home till 9:30, 10 o'clock, like, you know, so you're just missing so much. And yeah, and in fairness to Jim, he's always kind of tried to get the balance right and trying to reward like all of our team holidays, if I was a family, so he sends gifts back to the girls whenever he can, because he understands the sacrifice. He's been there as a player and he's been a manager for a long time, and it's more of a sacrifice at home. What Jim actually says is, they're the ones that make the sacrifice. We do what we love. We love to play football, and we do it every 4 or 5 times a week. They're at home living the reality, you know what I mean? So
nappies.
So thanks, Ciara.
So you meet Jim next week. Where's your head at? Have you made up your mind?
I'm 35 years of age. So the body, like, I'm actually, as of 2 weeks ago, I'm actually playing probably the best football I've played in 5 years. I'm looking forward to club championship at the weekend, back out training at the weekend. So I'm going to see how that goes. It's going to be so obviously we got over the line, we did the amazing five in a row and all that, so there's different challenges, different pressures. Like, it's a very it'll be a relaxed environment now. So, yeah, I'm just going to chat with Jim. See, I'm not 100% sure. I have to chat with Kira. She's the main gatekeeper to all this. But no, she'd never stand in the way of the passion. But yeah, it's just about kind of making the right decision for myself, my work, and all that and stuff like that. So
God, it's funny because I half expect you to just say, yeah, no, I'm done. That's it. So you're not ruling it out. Like, part of you wants to give it another.
Yeah, it's. I'm not sure. To be honest, I want to get through the club stuff. We're in the dogfight there. We've last game now in the group stages with Plunkett's on Saturday night against Raheny, the mighty Brian Howard and Brian Fenton that we have to deal with.
You're going to go on Fenton for a half hour, will you?
I'll run the legs off him. Yeah, I feel like I have the core, the engine for him. So we'll have a tough day out there. Yeah. But
so you want to see how that goes?
We're going through a transition with the club, yeah. And it's been tough. Because a lot of us are getting older. Alan hasn't been able to play as much. He's a few injuries and three kids at home as well and work and stuff like that. So I want to get through that for the next couple of weeks. But I want to meet Jim and just have an honest conversation with him and not come in to the meeting. This is what's happening, you know what I mean? Okay. Just have a chat with him and say, right, let's just, as you said, when I get injured, let's just war game it, you know what I mean? Yeah, whatever result will be, we'll have an open and frank conversation. But I'm not going to go in
With decision made. Fair enough.
Because Jim has been a big part of my career for the last long time, and we've won six All-Irelands together. We actually won, I was part of his first under 21 one in 2003, someone reminded me of, he was actually the manager of Dublin's first 21s title, and Alan was the captain. So I was actually part of that as well, so we go back a while. So,
you know, when you know someone that well, like you must be angry at him when he leaves you out then. Like, did you think, come on, Jim, seriously, come on.
Yeah, and I tried to look at it from both sides, is there room for sentiment? Is there room for romance? I'm a romantic, you know, like I am. I'm not going to say, and Jim knows I am, and I've said it to him, feedback loads of times. But I respect, like, at the end of the day, like when he rang me the first Kerry game, I said, you have to make the right calls for the team. I know you're making them sort of the team, or you're making them so you can give your best opinion on what the team is, should be in the day. So it's not a personal vendetta.
I'd say he found it hard. I'd say, like, but geez, he's ruthless. Like, that is cold. That is.
Yeah.
As he was picking up his phone to call you, have thought,
this is going to be a pleasant call.
We go back a while. He's not going to take this great. Yeah. Like, I'm really going to be messing his week up or, you know, his year up. I mean, not easy being a manager making those kind of calls.
Yeah, and I suppose the more high pressure the situation is, and obviously the bigger the glory, the more pressure the situation is. And he said it in training after a couple of the sessions, when he makes calls and meets people before training, and he's come into the team meeting and said, that's been a tough day, right. Like, you know, so he's human as well, you know, he doesn't like making the calls. Like, we all like to have the nice part of it, we don't like to make the tough calls, and but he takes his responsibility for well, and makes the calls that he believes are the right ones, and yeah, are they the right ones? That he says himself, he doesn't have all the answers either, he just tries to make them for the best interest of the team.
Well, I'd say the Jim McConnolly one was a tough one for him, because you're weighing up a lot. Like, he's looking at you, busting your ass for 2 years, not getting much game time. Jim could be, you know, off in Boston, but then you got to do what's right for the team.
Yeah, and he felt that was the right thing to give the team a bit of an extra angle. That's his decision as manager. Like, he's just trying to get what's best out over there.
How do you feel about that one?
It was tough for me. Like, it's not a direct. He didn't take my exact place, but he took a place on the bus, and then a place in the team. So in theory, it's another body in the way of me. But I've kind of gone past the personal. Like, I've had the days of personal glory. You know what I mean? Yeah, you want to be, like, definitely want to be involved in the bus. Like, it's a tough place to be, been left at home. But as long as the team gets over the line, it'll all be forgotten about in time. You know, as long as you can say, as long as you know that you've added something, I feel that I'm comfortable with that. Like, my dad left Dublin in 1983. He told me a story, and he got a box off an Offaly fullback. He caught one ball, popped it off for a goal, and he kind of gave a man a bit of a shoulder. And what do you think of that? And my dad was aging, and he was building the forward line around him, and. The next ball that came in, he caught the ball and woke up in Vincent's hospital. Your man clocked him. I don't know who it was. It was Sean Lowry or one of those lunatics. But and he said that he got a call a couple of weeks later looking for the jersey that he had. He'd just given it to the nurse or whatever. Mm-hmm. He took it off, and you don't think the management called him or something like that. And he just, and he kind of stayed with him for a while, and he kind of just said, whatever you do when you finish up, don't hold grudges and don't hold something. If you've something to say, say it. If you feel like something to say. But I don't hold. I'll have a chat with Jim. I'll give honest feedback. I'll tell him what I think. I'll tell him what I think he should do going forward. If I have any feedback for next year, if he's staying on or whatever, like I'd be very honest with him. And he'd be honest with me, and that's all you want. And that's if you have that environment, that's where there's learning, you know. But for me, I won't be when I meet him next week. I won't be walking out of it, falling out with him, or having begrudged him. Like we've went on a great journey together, and if it's to continue, we'll know at the end of that conversation. If it's not, we'll walk away and we'll be pals, because we'll dine on it.
A lot of good times as well. I guess to sum this thing up, last question really. You've been involved before, it got really, really good, and then you've seen it blossom into this thing. Why is it working so well over these last few years? Like, what is it about the group, about the dressing room? Like, Jack McCaffrey's almost, you know, he's like, I can't even express how much I love the people, you know, around me. I'm seeing shots of Steve. I didn't see much of the social media stuff, but I saw Stephen Cluxton sweeping the dressing room afterwards. Yeah. And like, I'm not sure, the lads are just having a good time and he's trying to sweep the dressing room. So there's a real collage of characters. Mm. Why do you feel it's worked so well in comparison with days where it mightn't have worked as well? What's the thing?
It's a number of things. Like, success obviously brings energy. The younger guys that came through, come into an environment that Jim is, he's always been building a team, so he's always been giving youth a chance. He's given them, like, the Cons, and these lads have come through, the Brian Howards, the Scullies, they've gotten game time, they've gotten time to bed in. So he's given an environment where young lads can excel and are given a chance, which is what you want in the high performance. When you want to sustain performance, you need to have that environment. But the group is tight. Like, they're a good bunch of lads, but they're very serious about their craft. They work really hard, they analyse hard, they sacrifice a lot. But they're good people as well, and they're good crack. Like, you know what I mean? There's banter when you have to have banter. There's banter, and for anyone who did see it, social media, see there's plenty. They're well out to have a good time.
Right.
They're not robots, as people say they are.
I don't even know who says that anymore.
Yeah.
Like, anytime any of you do an interview, it's clearly not robots.
Yeah,
anyway.
Yeah. Like, Jack McCaffrey is probably one of greatest characters ever. Like, he's a phenomenal human being.
One of my favorite things watching Dublin is in the parade where Jack McCaffrey's just walking around smiling.
Yeah.
You know, and you can tell he's just.
He does this creepy smile in the huddle. I don't know if you ever saw it, but he does it inside, and it's
creepy smile.
Beautifully creepy. Like, he literally just holds a smile, and doing it 3 or 4, I don't know how long he's doing, a few years, and it's literally, we ask for it. Like we kind of say, Jack, you didn't smile today. Like, what was the story? Like, literally, it's part of our preparation now to look at Jack and kind of go, that's weird, but amazing.
So you're doing that in the huddle before big games is almost a, this isn't life or death.
Jack is, like, I have that kind of philosophy of you play well when you're in a good, feel good, play good. Like,
not,
you know,
not tight and nervous.
Tight, you're relaxed, you're playing the sport you love, it's a game, you're out here, like, what a great place to be, what an honour to represent your family and your county in front of thousands of people.
You could be up in the Littlewoods box looking down and,
exactly,
you know,
yeah,
so you might as well smile.
Exactly, smile when you have it, yeah.
I look forward to seeing Jack McCaffrey and asking him to do his creepy smile. He's going to thank you for that.
It's magic.
Listen, good man, well done. Like, geez, I'm saying that, I'm sure there were plenty of tough days there. 7-0 Ireland is nothing to laugh at, and sure, if we see you next year, great. Whatever you want to do, you'll do. Bernard Brogan, thanks so much.
Thanks, man, Joe. Cheers, appreciate it.